Are we ready to start? Yeah, okay, thank you very much and welcome to what is the last Full City Region Overview Scrutiny Committee for this municipal year. Can I make sure your phones are turned to silent? And can I remind members and presenters to use microphones where presented, please? And they actually work better when your mouth is close to them and they're pointing towards you. Okay, number one, agenda item one, do we have any apologies for absence?
I've received apologies from Councillor Dutton, Councillor Anderson, Councillor Baines and Councillor Hurley.
Do we have any other apologies? Councillor Murphy, Councillor Lewis. Okay. Looking down our list, I think that means that this meeting isn't actually a quorum. We need 14 members present. I think there are 12 members currently here. As a result of that, we will carry on with the meeting. We will record the minutes, but as an incorporated scrutiny committee, the recommendations that we will need make will have to be draft recommendations. Okay?
Can I just say, Chair, it's a problem, isn't it? We weren't quorum at the last meeting, so it means decision to be made at the last meeting, we can't ratify at this meeting. I think Bill's just said we were also a quorum at the meeting before, so this is the third. So what's actually happening is, no matter what we discuss at this meeting, or what we decide, whatever recommendation we come up with, we can't do anything with it because we haven't got enough people here to ratify our decision, and that's quite worrying.
That's a good point, Councillor.
Is there any way, I'm finished, Chair, is there any way we can reduce the quorum number? That's where I'm going to finish on.
Okay, sorry, Councillor Sullivan. What we have as part of our agenda is the annual report, and I suggest that we have that discussion with regard to the effectively the constitution of the Overview and Scrutiny Committee at that point. Okay, so taking on board the points that you're making, but as part of the agenda, I think there is an agenda item where that would be more appropriate. Councillor Wainwright, if we could just pick you up.
Yeah, Chair, I was just going to recommend that yourself and the two vice chairs meet with a view to sort this out once and for all.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine, thank you. All right, okay. Declarations of interest.
I haven't received any, Chair.
Number three, minutes of the meeting of the LCR Combined Authority held on the 25th of October 2017, the 24th of January 2018. Okay, those have been tabled separately. I wasn't at either of those meetings, and I would like to thank both Councillor Wainwright and Councillor Murphy for standing in the chair of those in my absence.
I'll move the LCR meetings.
Okay, Councillor Murphy? Okay, thank you. If we have no comments or questions on that, let's move those minutes.
Okay.
Okay, we are actually waiting. Agenda item four is a verbal update from Metro Mayor Steve Rotherman. I don't know if we're actually expecting him there or if we're having a report tabled by.
We are expecting him there, yes.
Okay.
Sure.
Yes. Okay. So given that we're waiting for the Mayor, could I suggest that we move on to agenda item five, which is the feedback from the LCR Combined Authority on the recommendations of the Task and Finish Group that worked on the spatial development strategy. In the documentation for this committee, we have the report. I was very fortunate to present the findings of the Spatial Development Strategy Task and Finish Group to the Combined Authority at their meeting in March. The Combined Authority welcomed the recommendations and in doing so agreed an action plan to ensure the implementation of those recommendations. The action plan is detailed at page 13 in our notes. Do members have any questions on this? Councillor Murphy.
Chair, just to, this is the first time that this committee has received the action plan for what we can do, Councillor Murphy, we can get an email round with an update on those actions that have been completed for members, and we can bring to the next or future scrutiny meeting an update on the whole of the action plan and have that as an agenda item if that's something you would want.
Hi, okay, we can go back. Just one second, Mr. Do we have any other questions on agenda item 5, which is our spatial development strategy report from the Task and Finish group? No? Okay, so we'll note that, we note the action plan, and we'll ask for that to come back and we can be updated on that. Okay, if we can go to agenda item 4, I'd like to welcome the Metro Mayor, who's going to give a verbal update on the progress to date. Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. Where to start? Really, huge amounts has happened since I last was able to update the committee. In February, I suppose I'll start with the combined authority budget. Not always a straightforward process, but fantastic that we were able to secure a budget for the next 12 months. And that gives us the opportunity to address some of the capacity concerns that were raised by this committee. So we've put an awful lot of things into place, and I'll go through them bit by bit. The other part of the budget was that we were able to put £1.6 million into mayoral priorities, a mayoral priorities fund, and that's going to support some of those big issues. Remember when we talked about the amazing tidal power project, we talked about digital connectivity, those sort of things. All of that has to be said, it's predicated on, it has to be inclusive growth. And Councillor Robinson Collins has certainly highlighted that on a number of occasions to me, but that's what it will be. And also, about our transport priorities, and again, people will be aware that we've got £134 million from the government in what's called transforming cities monies. So it really does give us an opportunity now to think about how we can use some of this funding a bit more creatively than we otherwise would have been able to have done. The internal stuff that I mentioned about capacity, we've embarked on a lengthy process to ensure that we fill key positions, and also we've started the integration of the combined authority with major travel staff. So at every single stage of this, to ensure every single member, we've included the unions, and we've had meetings on each of the floors here, and also we've invited staff to several events downstairs when we turn those three separate rooms into one big room, and staff can ask any questions or raise any concerns that they have. I've been through these sorts of change processes before, and I know that it's better to take people along with you than to try afterwards to explain what it is that you're trying to do. We want them, the staff here, to be very much part of this, not only to be part of it, actually to start to direct how we can become an exemplar employer. So all SMT posts are now filled, and those people are in place. Mark Bousfield, who started on Monday, in his post as the director of commercial investment, he, I'm certain, will turn into an absolute star for us, somebody with a completely different skill set than you would normally find in the public sector. Somebody who will be able to look at the money that we get much more innovatively, and to make certain we do get that multiplier effect that we spoke about, so we can do some of the things that we all want to do on behalf of the people we represent. We've got Kirsty Pearce. She starts in May, but she's going to be Director of Policy and Strategic Commissioning. Kirsty is a former civil servant. She worked very closely in the North West on behalf of the government. So if you like, we've got somebody who's a protege gamekeeper, somebody who knows the routes into government and how we can maximise the opportunities and fund the pots from what happens in London to try and get more of it to come here. We've got our Chief Legal Officer, our Democratic Services Manager, our Lead Officer for Spatial Planning, all now appointed. All the big roles that we're concerned about, they are all now filled. And at the sort of the lower tiers, we've got people who are being progressed on a weekly basis. So again, capacity, we think, will be probably done and dusted in the next two, three months at most. In March, we launched a programme which is a pioneering initiative called Households into Work. And it's a pilot, the first of its kind in the country. It's only came about because we have a devolution agreement. We wouldn't have got this. It's the six districts coming together. We'll see a team of 24 advocates, all based in the local authorities within the councils. And they'll be providing intensive support to get 800 unemployed families back into work. And the advocates will be dealing with household where there's two or more people in a household who are unemployed, and trying to work as an advocate working in partnership with all the agencies to identify the barriers that they have which prevent them getting into work. Issues such as childcare, a huge problem that we have, debt, skills gaps, a whole host of different things, but it's to provide a wraparound service for them. At its last meeting at the combined authority, we approved again something we're facing the country to do this. We approved a strategy, a cultural strategy, where we're top slicing and giving a percentage of our money to culture. It's called 8% for culture. It's a pledge which will initially enable us to use £300,000 per year to commit solely to cultural activities. And that funding will go into a programme which will be a borough of culture. So, for instance, this year, St Helens will get their first chance. They are borough of culture for 2018. That alongside, of course, Liverpool always being the epicentre of culture in the city region. So Liverpool will always be the major focus, but we do have indigenous culture, and that's some of it really interesting culture outside of Liverpool. St Helens has the opportunity to shine this particular year, and then we'll take turns to piece, if you like, around the other borders, so everybody gets there one year in the spotlight, gets some funding. That £300,000 is only the start of it. That act as a catalyst, and we're hoping that that will generate multiples of many times that £300,000 to really start to tease out indigenous culture in our five boroughs. It's also for each year, we'll have the City Region Cultural Awards ceremony, and we will be also on top of all this looking at what we'll do about small cultural project grants. And we're also on top of all of that, giving £5 million to Liverpool's cultural programme, which is a celebration of 10 years since Liverpool's the European Catholic Culture. That's a one off. We can see that we really believe that culture is an opportunity for us to capitalise on our fantastic heritage, the big events that we do, but also the visitor economy. It's massive. We want people not just to come here, we want them to stay longer, we want them to spend more money whilst they're here, but we want them to come to Liverpool for them to go and taste what happened in Liverpool or in Southport or in Bolton or wherever else. We marked National Apprenticeship Week. When I launched the region's City Region's Leadership Growth Plan alongside Ian Mayer, who's the portfolio holder, who's the leader of CEFN, and we're looking to increase the number of apprenticeships over the next few years. The plan has really aspirational targets to deliver 20,000 apprenticeships per year by 2020, as well as including a vision on how the apprenticeship system and its reforms could be made to work for our city region, and particularly using our linkages with our trade unions, with the employers, colleges, with the training providers, but all of those with the idea of creating more degree level and gold standard apprenticeships right away across the board, but specifically for me, looking at areas of growth such as the digital economy and the fourth industrial revolution. I was glad to welcome experts and be joined on a summit by public, private and voluntary sectors to discuss the ideas around mental health, and we held a summit on the 2nd of March where representatives across the city region all came together, and it's about improving the understanding of mental health in the workplace, a really big issue. That's something that I take very, very seriously, and obviously as soon as I was elected as Metro Mayor, I appointed Luciana Virgia, who's recognised nationally as being an expert in mental health issues, and she's the medical advisor for us all. I also took the opportunity to sign the Time for Change employer pledge on behalf of the Combined Authority. Again, the first Combined Authority, one of the first authorities of any sort across the country to really commit to these sorts of things, and that alongside some of the other things that I've teased out to you in the past just shows you how we as a combined authority are in many instances leading in the whole country. The next bit is, I'll go back a little stage just to say that previously I've been a huge sceptic of things like NICU. I was critical saying that, you know, it could be perceived as being a jolly. So I refused initially to go, but I was convinced it was paid for by the private sector, so it wasn't paid for by us. The private sector wanted somebody from the public sector to go. They wanted me to be their representative. I agreed to go. It was the worst jolly that you could ever have, ever. It was an intensive four-day event. I did 40 individual events, 27 speeches. We spoke to literally hundreds of individuals. We had slots right away from early in the morning right through to the evening. And we've been able to change people's misperceptions, it has to be said, what we're about. Look, it's great that we've got the Beagles, it's great that we've got two football teams and all that sort of stuff. But we need to get the message out there that we are a 21st century city region and that we are at the heart of what's happening in the fourth industrial revolution. We can do that face to face with global investors, with sovereign wealth funds, with people literally queuing to speak to me, not because of my charm and charisma, it has to be said, but because on my badge it has Liverpool City Region. I was on a platform with the Metro Mayor of West Midlands, and it was difficult because who knows what the West Midlands are. It's a fellow called Andy Street, and Andy Street is a former Chief Executive Officer of John Lewis Partnership, and he was struggling to sell West Midlands. We are so fortunate to have Liverpool as the attack ground, and literally there were queues and people waiting and trying to get appointments to speak to myself. Mayor Anderson was there for a short space of time, but also we had a team from the private sector from all corners of the city region with one single message. And we really did sell that message, and it was hugely successful. And the proof of the pudding is always, isn't it, getting these deals over the line. Well, we report that back to the Supreme Power in the forthcoming months, but there's really good news stemming from this. So I'm less of a skeptic this year. We held Transport for the North inaugural meeting here downstairs in the city region. It was a great opportunity, I think, for us to again to ensure that the North was speaking with one voice. We in London have been very powerful in lobbying government for huge chunks of national infrastructure funding. It's because they've been able to do that. They've had this one voice. We've had sometimes people in the Liverpool City region saying different things. So we're getting our together on a national scale, ourselves with Mayor Burnham of the Brit of Manchester and myself speaking with one voice for the North West. With that northern corridor start to come together now, it was a great, I think, opportunity, crucial for the Liverpool City region, so that we can really start to put the pressure on to get the faster line to Manchester first of all, as part of the first stage of the west-east connectivity, but also that links into the north-south connectivity. It's transformative for our economic futures. GVA was £16 billion, but over and above that, it will shrink the city region, it will shrink the travel to work area. It will mean, genuinely, if you think about housing, just as an I say as the part of this, if you've got 20-minute journeys between those two great cities, where would you rather live? Seriously, it doesn't matter what big year you have to work in. I think there are dangers for Manchester. All of a sudden, you can work in Manchester, but you can live in it somewhere that where it does has culture at its heart, somewhere with fantastic waterfronts and all the amenities that we have. I think, again, for us, it's a game changer. I'm glad to report, following many months of lobbying from us and calls from myself and others to try and get conciliation talks without preconditions, the two parties with the RMT and Mersey Rail have had those initial discussions, and I've always believed that we can only find a resolution to the dispute if both sides sit around a table, talk to each other about the differences that they have, but also what their hopes are for the future. So I'm hoping that something tangible will come from that. But that's a real start, and I just hope that it does continue to progress the way we all wish it to. And then finally, Chair, just to yourself, thank you. I believe you're an outgoing Chair. Thank you for all of your efforts over the past few months. Scrutiny for me, and I said this at the very earliest occasion, scrutiny is an important, an integral part of everything that we want to do here. I believe the opportunity for people to ask those questions, to review, to investigate, to challenge, to consult, to give guidance, to make recommendations, all of that is about the functions of this thing that we're trying to create here, this combined authority. And the bit that you've played in the chair and each of the members has been exemplary. We really do want to ensure that that scrutiny is at the forefront of everything that we do. I want to shine that light into all of the corners of what it is. I don't want any areas that are no-go areas. I don't want people to create myths about what it is that we're trying to achieve. And it's through this body, I think, that we do that. We can demystify, debunk some of that nonsense that happens outside. So, as regard in relation to the role that each of you will take, and for those seeking re-election, very best of luck. And hopefully, I'll see you back here in May or June or whenever it is at the next meeting. Thank you, Chair. I'm happy to take any questions.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Steve, for that report. Steve, I could be here all day asking you questions also. You mentioned briefly transport. Now this committee looked at transport 18 months ago. We're paying some of the highest bus fares in the country here, and on Wirral, I might add. The short journeys on Wirral, which are the highest in the country. Now Arriva, Stagecoach, they're milking the transport here. They're milking the most vulnerable in our society. And people using buses has dropped dramatically in the last 12 months. What are your plans, Steve? You only mentioned briefly transport. So what are your plans for transport? And I hope they are far-reaching, may I say. Next question. The unemployed, you mentioned 800 long-term unemployed trying to get these families back into work and working with the families. Sounds like a good initiative. Where are the 800 families who are these chronic unemployed, may I say? Whereabouts in the region are they? So are you working with people as far away as Halton, and are you working with people in the Wirral? So if you could give us an idea of where those 800 are. You mentioned childcare. Our childcare in this country is the most expensive in the world, never mind in Europe. It's the most expensive childcare, and this is one of the biggest barriers for people, getting people back into work and people who are in work. Now the government have advertised it's now 30 hours child-free places. It's incredibly difficult. I'm getting more and more complaints in my ward over on the Wirral. Families trying to access people who are in work. People, my youngest daughter got refused. It was only yesterday. right? And my youngest daughter's a solicitor, so she's not stupid. And she couldn't access it. It's horrific. Is there anything we can do? Is there anything your office can do, as well as all of us individually? Because I'm sure this will be a problem in all the boroughs, not just over on the Wirral. I look forward to your feedback on your jolly, because I'm sceptical about them. I'm looking at what the ones that Phil Davis has been on chair of the business committee over on the Wirral. And I'm sceptical about them. And see, but I am looking forward to some feedback when you're saying, well, as a result of that trip, we've now got this investment, that investment is coming into the city region. So I look forward to that. And the last point, Chair, thank you for allowing me this time, Chair. The guards on the trains. You said you're hoping there's not going to be a magic wand, Steve. Mersey Travel seemed to me like they're intransigent and they want to get rid of the guards.
Rail.
Mersey Rail, sorry, Mersey Travel. Mersey Rail. It seems to me that it's intransigent, again, from the boss's side, not from the trade union. So I hope this dispute can be resolved amicably, may I say, and for the good of the passengers, the disabled and the vulnerable passengers who use our trains. Thanks, Stephen. Thanks, okay. Chair, for allowing me that time.
Thank you,
Councillor Sullivan. Yeah, I'll have time to go through the order that they were proposed. In regard to buses and bus fares, we also have the most beneficial and generous concessionary travel scheme of anywhere outside. And so we recognise that. We obviously understand that the biggest inhibitors for people to be able to take job opportunities, and certainly apprenticeship opportunities, is the cost of travel. And we, as an authority, can only tamper around the edges currently, but there are opportunities. I think what you were alluding to is the bus services bill 2017 and what the provisions of that might mean for us. And there's a report going to the combined authority this week, so Friday this week, which will tease out what our approach to the opportunity of doing something around that is. It's quite complicated, to tell you the truth. It's not straightforward, as people basically need to be. Greater Manchester finding this out to their cost, they thought they'd be able to get some people better quickly. The process is lengthy. We want to get it right. We want to get it absolutely spot on. We want to work with all the partners to ensure that we do that. I'm speaking to Stagecoach this week. I've spoken to others. It's all about what we can do, what the art of the achievable is. But we'll have more to report on this in the coming weeks, certainly months, because it's going to take some considerable time. I do want to do stuff on bus fares, I want to look at that anyway. But that's by talking with the current powers that we have, by talking with the operators, and ensuring that we can get the best fares that we possibly can, given the limited powers that we have. Household into work, you're spot on about childcare. Childcare is hugely important to those people who are not currently in work, and it's how again we use the opportunity of this funding. It is a pilot scheme. It will be centred around 800. They will be across the six districts. The advocates that we're paying for as well, because we're paying money to this as a combined authority, money from government, but our money. But those advocates, 24 of them, they've been trained, they've had their induction here. I spoke to them indeed in the gym just over to my left. Each of those people will be going out and with their own case load trying to target households. And some of these are the most difficult groups to really penetrate, to find what complexity of those issues are that prevent them from into work. So big piece of work, it is a pilot. We want it to be successful, because if it's successful, it'll be rolled out. If it's rolled out, of course, then our people will benefit. But 800 families, that's at least 1,600 people each year, will get the benefit of what we're trying to achieve here. And just in regard to childcare, fortunate and unfortunate thing about being the natural mayor is that the fortunate thing is that you can do certain things, the unfortunate thing is that you can't do the things that you can't do. And you don't become the president of the United States when you get elected, unfortunately. So you haven't got those powers to really affect change to national systems. I'm afraid the childcare system in this country is broken and it needs, in my opinion, a change of government, but that's only a change. NIPM, I did say there's no cost for us really, other than no cost, but we were funded through the private sector. It's a private sector led delegation. The private sector would have done this anyway, but they believe that it's hugely beneficial to the economy of the city region. What I saw with my own two eyes was that you have to be there for people to take you seriously as a global player. And to have that empty chair is a bit burnt hair share, really. It's great for us to go out and say, oh, we're not taking part in all this sort of stuff. I want good job opportunities to come here. I want in with investment. I want the right inclusive growth, but I want in with investment. I want those high value jobs to look at the Liverpool City region if they're looking to come to the UK or into Europe, because by doing all of that, that releases some funding by which we can do the things that we would like to do. So it has to be both ends of the telescope, and that's why I think it was such a huge benefit. And the other thing is, as I say, for me to test my hypothesis that Liverpool as a brand has got global reach beyond anything else, for me to go up there and see the results of that, it is absolutely something that I can prove the reach of the Liverpool City Region brand. Remember us telling you that Eric Pickles wanted us to become the hub and the Liverpool City talent, Seth and Will combined authority. How we would have sold that, I don't know, but Liverpool City Region, Liverpool City, the Liverpool Cup. And I couldn't agree with you less in regard to intransigence from Mersey Rail. Mersey Rail have, I think, done what they can do with the limited options sometimes, and both sides need, if you come to any resolution on anything, if you have an argument with anybody, if you have a negotiation with anybody, it has to be both parties coming with a willing attitude to try and find a solution. That's what we've currently got. So I don't want to point the finger at any particular part of what the dispute's about. The most important thing is now about how we progress it. Whatever's gone, if we've aligned it, we want, everybody wants, both sides, but everybody out there, they want a 21st century transport system. And we can do that. £460 million we're invested into the rolling stock. They're going to be the most sophisticated trains in the whole of Europe. They are something that when people come here, they will go, wow, this is a place really on the up. Now we've got 50, 60 year old rolling stock at that point. This will really, I think, be a fantastic thing for the whole city region, for people outside, but for people who travel, people with disabilities, men and women with buggies, people who are slightly infirm. You'll be coming off the platform, trains will be at the same height as the actual platform. These are brilliant for people with disabilities. These are the sort of things that our Labour government will be supporting, and they do. This rolling stock's going to be owned by us. We're the first in the country to be doing this. This is Labour Party policy writ large. We should be celebrating what's happened. And once we get over this dispute, and hopefully we'll come to a resolution, I think that this is something that we'll all celebrate. It's hugely important to us. And look, at the end of the day, it's all about affordability. We were talking about bus fares before and costs. One of the alternatives is that if we have to find £5 million, we have to put train fares up, and we have to put other fares up so that we can at least get the income stream to guarantee that we can have a second safety critical person on every train. There's always a balance to these things. We can do away with concessionary travel for people over 60, between 60 and 67, if that was the decision by the Transport Authority. As politicians, you try and sell that. The There's always difficult decisions for us to take. I'm hopeful that with this process of talks now with an independent conciliator, that we'll find a solution to the future.
Excellent, thank you very much. Councillor Wainwright.
Thank you, Chair. First, thank you for your kind words, Chair. I also say that the job of the President of the United States isn't what it wants for us. But I suggest you stay, it's all value for money being referred to the United States. Being the President of the United States would suggest that the President. Well, moving forward, just a couple of questions, Steve. One is surrounding budget. I don't know the budget has been passed, but this committee would still like to see a line by line budget process go through. I know we've got a meeting, I think, next week to go through that. But with regards to the papers that were out, we would like to see a line by line so we know exactly where money's going, so the public know exactly where money's going, so everything is transparent. I'm not suggesting for 1 minute that it isn't transparent for it, but I'd like to go a bit deeper than most people. I'm not like a ball when it comes to, I'd like to find out what's going on, where money's going. Luciana Berger could have been a final appointment as an advisor on mental health. I listened to her a couple of years ago when we were at Brighton, and she definitely knows her stuff. She taught me a few things, and I'm not one for mental health issues apart from knowing people who suffer from mental health issues, and the worst thing in the world for those people suffering from it, and for the families who have to deal with it in some cases. Let's go to Mersey Travel. I'd like to ask a question on Mersey Travel, and do you foresee any issues or problems with the merger with the City Region, Combined Authority and Mersey Travel? And who's going to pick up the expensive costs of the Mersey Travel Committee, which will now become officially the committee of the Combined Authority, because you still have a chair on a £30,000 price tag, and the members of that committee were on quite a few of them as well. Who's going to pick up that cost?
Okay, right. Thanks, Councillor Wainwright. On budget issue. On budget issues, you're quite right. You should have access to any of the information that you want. In regard to the process itself, that's obviously something that the six leaders all agree. Then it goes before the Combined Authority here, which is a public meeting. The results of that are posted in public, so we are as public as anywhere else. I'd say much more public in regard to what we do on our budgeting process. If there's anything in particular you wanted to see, I'm more than happy for you to do that, but you'll obviously tease out when you meet with John. John knows his way exactly like yourself around spreadsheets and all that sort of stuff, so we can extrapolate whatever it is that you're actually trying to drill down to get to the issue. On the Mersey side, it's not a merger in as much as we are one body. There aren't separate bits now, so it's more to do with integrating the staff. So the Combined Authority is the authority. In fact, it's not the authority. The Metro Mayor is the authority now. So I become that authority. But what I want to do is to ensure, again, through scrutiny, but we have a process which is open and transparent. And whilst I think you're right that we have a chair who is paid for that role, I'd say I'd look more at value for money. We get an unbelievable deal in currently having our chair, which is Councillor Lee Robinson, who does get £24,000. It is, and that's a game as part of a public process. Anyone can see that. But he's doing the job. If we had to have somebody who's a chief executive doing that role, probably around £200,000. It's unbelievable value that we get. Somebody with the expertise that brings that role. And the committee and the structure, again, is decided by the leaders. And there have been, for years, attempts to try and change what that might be. And does it go on population size, or does it go on equity, so each of these six local authorities all get the same? That will will be for them to decide this year, to decide the process during this year, so that next year we're all aware of it. And there is an allowance scheme. The allowance scheme is published at each of those individual councillors who are part of that committee, because there's a committee now rather than an authority. But each of those does get an allowance. That's a public allowance scheme. It's picked up by the local authorities. It's not the provider authority that pays for any of those allowances. So you'd have to ask individual councils about the scheme that they administer on our behalf.
Okay, thank you very much. I've seen Councillor Roberts' comments.
Thank you, Chair. A couple of things, not quite long the list as all my colleagues. Really positively, it was great that your office has announced the intention to be the most digitally inclusive region, city region. Obviously, there's a big gap between being the most digitally inclusive and announcing the intention, but I think that's a really, really positive step, because certainly there's been so much good work done in the city on that, so much good work going on, but to have the resource that is your office kind of to coordinate or promote some of that and to build that into our skills agenda is really, really positive. So that's fabulous news, well done on that. And then two other sort of bit more difficult things, and I appreciate you're not the President of the United States, so I can't understand that. But in terms of, and they're both government issues, but in terms of kind of using your authority to lobby and sort of lobby on behalf of the city region, one we discussed a couple of meetings ago here about the apprenticeship levy and the kind of concerns about what is, could potentially be lost money. Certainly I know from my experience in local city council, even where we've got money to do recruitment now, kind of accessing the apprenticeship levy and making sure we can use that on the right routes and stuff is just so difficult. So given that public bodies are putting into the apprenticeship levy, obviously is there any hope of any more flexibility or something in how we can use that? Because if we're paying into that and then we can't really benefit from that, that would be just a crying shame. And similarly, again, a government issue, but maybe you can use more influence. And I know that you were at Liverpool Council's Skills and Employment Select Committee a while ago, so you probably dealt with this there, and I'm sorry I wasn't at that meeting. But with the job centre closures and the DWP's kind of intransigence and unhelpful attitude and the way they kind of offload DWP costs and think, isn't that fantastic, we've saved all this money. Actually, they've just shoved it onto various other public authorities and the voluntary sector. And Liverpool Council in particular tried really, really hard to get the DWP to negotiate with us, and we were offering co-location at a really cost-effective price, but their lack of devolutionary spirit and lack of partnership working has always been a problem with DWP. But is there anything that you can do now to kind of maybe bridge that gap and help change some of those decisions?
I'll pick up the last one only because it's fresh in my mind. We get an opportunity, and that's all it is, to meet with secretaries of the civil service. And at the last one, there was about four permanent secs, and there was senior civil servants, including somebody from DWP. So I took the opportunity when it was quite fresh, that we just closed down Norris Green, I think, and we closed the Walton one down, which I was...
Attention, please. Attention, please.
But
we are
I did all
about to commence a test of the fire alarm system.
Open, but I said
do
to
not